Hello friends, today we'll be discussing about the anatomy of the foot. This is Dr. Yusuf signing from Al Jawf University, Saudi Arabia. So these are the specific objectives which we follow in the College of Medicine in Al Jawf University. The first one is describe motor and sensory nerve supply of the foot. Study the arrangement of the layers of the sole of the foot from superficial to deep. Name the muscles of the foot and give their actions and nerve supply. Fourth, describe the plantar aponeurosis, fibrous flexor sheath and synovial sheath of the foot and toes. And fifth, describe the arches of the foot, the factors responsible for their maintenance and list their deformities. So these are some of the objectives which are supposed to be covered today. So to begin with, the anatomy of the foot, to have a brief idea, the muscles of the sole of the foot are 18. These are called as intrinsic muscles. The muscles which are within the sole, they are called as intrinsic muscles. The muscles which extend from the anterior and posterior compartment of the leg into the foot, they are called as extrinsic muscles. So intrinsic muscles are those which are within the foot. They begin, they take origin within the foot and get inserted within the foot. Okay, so these are intrinsic muscles. So there are 18 intrinsic muscles in case of the sole of the foot. Compare this with the hand. If you see in the hand, where there are 20 intrinsic muscles within the hand, for thenar, for hypothenar, for dorsal introsciae, for palmar introsciae, and for lumbricals. So 4 × 5, 20 muscles. But here we have 2 lesser, that is 18 intrinsic muscles, and there are 4 extrinsic muscles which will be extending from the leg, as I said, from the leg into the foot. So usually, instead of the muscle, the extension of the muscle, that is a tendon, will be extending into the foot. And these 18 intrinsic muscles are arranged in 4 layers. In the first layer, there are 3 muscles, 3 intrinsic muscles. In the second layer, there are 5 muscles. In the third layer, there are 3 again. And in the fourth layer, there are 7 muscles, totally 18. So this formula is called as 3-5-3-7. So in the 3 muscles in the first layer, second layer will have 5, and again the third layer will have 3 muscles, and the fourth layer will consist of 7 muscles. So if you see the nerve supply, out of these 18 muscles, 4 muscles are only supplied by the medial plantar nerve. The remaining 14 are supplied by the lateral plantar nerve. So if you want to know which is the nerve of the foot, so it should be the lateral plantar nerve along with contribution from the medial plantar, because lateral plantar nerve will be supplying 14 muscles out of the 18 muscles. Similar in case of the hand, if you see, out of the 20 intrinsic muscles, 15 to 16 are supplied by the ulnar nerve. So if you want to confirm which is the nerve of the hand, then it should be the ulnar nerve, contribution with the other nerves. So similarly here, ulnar nerve can be compared to the lateral plantar nerve here, because it will be supplying 14 muscles out of the 18 muscles. So before we study this muscle, we should know something called as the plantar aponeurosis. Again, compare this with the hand. So there is also a aponeurosis which is called as the palmar aponeurosis. So these aponeurosis are nothing but the modified defacia. These are nothing but the modified defacia. And here in case of the foot, it is called as plantar aponeurosis. And this consists of bundles of collagen fibers arranged longitudinally. So if you can see here, this is the plantar aponeurosis and its fibers extending longitudinally. So this is nothing but the modified defacia in case of the foot, which is called as the plantar aponeurosis. Similarly, in case of the hand, it is called as the palmar aponeurosis. So even in case of the hand, it is triangular in shape. Here also we have this plantar aponeurosis, which is triangular in shape, with the apex directed towards the heel and the base is extending towards the digits, the fingers or the toes here in case of the foot. So this, if you see the attachment, posteriorly it is attached to something called an extension from the, this is the calcaneus bone. So from there is a small tubercle here on the medial side. This is called a medial tubercle. Similarly, we have the lateral tubercle here. So this aponeurosis, the apex of this aponeurosis is towards the medial tubercle of the calcaneus bone. Okay, so this is the apex. And if you see the base will be splitting into 5 digits for. So if you can see here, the 5 slips for 5 digits of the toes, and they will go and get inserted to the metatarsal heads of all the toes, and from there it extends into the flexor sheath. There is again modified deep fascia around these digits, that is called the flexor sheath, and this will go and get invaginated within the flexor sheath. So this is called as the plantar aponeurosis, with the apex directed towards the medial tubercle of the calcaneus, and the base is split into 5 slips, and the 5 slips will go to the metatarsal heads and from there to the flexor sheath. Why should we have this plantar aponeurosis? So this is a very important question which you are supposed to ask. Okay, so so what are the functions? Okay, so the functions are, one is it maintains the longitudinal arch. So there's something called as arches in the foot. Foot is not flat, but it has arch. Okay, so this arch is maintained by this plantar aponeurosis. It will hold this is called as the longitudinal arches. There are medial longitudinal arch as well as lateral longitudinal arch. There are also transverse arches, but this will be helpful in maintaining the longitudinal arch. So this arch will be held by the, we'll study these arches later. So you should know that this plantar aponeurosis will be helping in the maintenance of these longitudinal arches. How? We'll study it later. Okay. The second function is it provides origin of the superficial plantar muscles. If you can see here, just deep to this, there are some superficial muscles in the first layer of sole. So these muscles will be taking origin not only from the bone, but also some part will take origin, an additional origin for these muscles will be from this plantar aponeurosis. And the third and most important is it protects the plantar vessels and nerves from compression, because it is in the sole. And if you are walking on an uneven floor or on a rough surface, especially in case of olden days when they never used to use slippers or shoe or something like that at that time, and if they are walking on the uneven surface on some rough ground, and whenever they walk, there are important nerves and blood vessels and nerves here within the sole which will be supplying these muscles. So if there is no plantar aponeurosis, then they will be direct in contact with the uneven surface, and if there is any stone or something like that, and they will hit it, and these plantar vessels and nerves are prone for injury. So this plantar aponeurosis will protect the structures deep inside. So it will protect the plantar vessels and nerves deep inside this sole. Okay, so these are some of the important functions of the plantar aponeurosis. One, it maintains the longitudinal arch. Second, it provides origin for the superficial plantar muscles. And the third is it protects the plantar vessels and nerves from compression. So these are some of the functions of the plantar aponeurosis. Now we'll study the muscles one by one, starting with the first layer. As I said, the formula is 3-5-3-7. So in the first layer, there are three muscles. The three muscles are the flexor digitorum brevis. If you can see here, this is the muscle which is called the flexor digitorum brevis. Flexor because this is in the flexor compartment. In case of the leg, if you remember, the posterior compartment is called a flexor compartment, and these muscles will extend even into the foot. So this is the plantar surface. So it will extend to the plantar surface. So all these will be helping in the flexion. Similarly, the muscles which are intrinsic muscle that I was talking about, that was about the extrinsic muscle. Here we have intrinsic muscle. These are also in the sole. So all these muscles will help in the plantar flexion. So this is called the the flexor. So the first name is flexor digitorum because it is dividing and going to the lateral four toes. So that's what is called a digitorum. If you remember, flexor digitorum longus we have studied in case of the leg, the posterior compartment of leg. The tendon will also be extending here. If you can see here, this is the flexor digitorum longus, which is coming from the leg into the foot, and this is this flexor digitorum brevis. How it differs, we will talk about it later in detail. The second muscle, the brevis, because it is a small muscle, so that's why it is called as brevis, which is because this is an intrinsic muscle and it's a small muscle. The longus will be coming from the leg, so it will be called as, it is a long muscle with long tendon, so it will be coming from the leg, so it is called as longus. And the small short muscle, so it is called as the brevis. So that's why it is called as flexor digitorum brevis. The second muscle is the abductor hallucis. So the name itself indicates many things. So here it is hallucis because the great toe is called as hallux. Hallux is the great toe. So it is a muscle which is acting on the great toe. So that's why it is called as hallucis. And abductor, depending on the function, because it is on the medial side, it will be abducting the great toe. That's what is called as abductor hallucis. The third muscle here is the abductor digiti minimi. Digiti minimi means little finger. If you remember, similarly in case of the hand also, we have digiti minimi. The little finger is called as the digiti minimi. Similarly here, the little toe will be called as the digiti minimi. And the function of this muscle is abduction. So that's why it is called as the abductor digiti minimi. So these are the three muscles which are there in case of the first layer. So we'll talk about the origin insertion of these muscles as well as nerve supply and actions. Coming to begin with, the flexor digitorum brevis, it will be taking origin from the again from the similar to the aponeurosis. This also take origin here. You can see a tubercle. This is called as the medial tubercle of the calcaneum. So this is taking origin from the medial tubercle of the calcaneum as well as the plantar aponeurosis. As I said, the muscles of the first layer also have an additional origin from the plantar aponeurosis. So this muscle also take origin from the plantar aponeurosis along with the bone. Insertion will be, it will be going to the margins of the middle phalanx of the lateral four toes. If you remember the flexor digitorum longus, we had discussed that this will be the tendons which will be going to the lateral four toes. Lateral because the great toe will be on the medial side, so it will be counted from here. So this will be the first toe, second toe, third, fourth and fifth. Just compare with the hand. In case of the hand, the thumb is taken as the first finger. So, and that is on the lateral side. Here in the great toe is on the medial side, as we remember, because this is because the lower limb has rotated medially, and that's why the great toe has come towards the medial side. But in case of the hand, there was rotation on the lateral side during development, so the thumb has gone to the lateral side. So the thumb will be the first finger there, second, third, fourth, it will be counted from lateral to medial side. Here it will be from medial to lateral side because the great toe is on the medial side. So this is the first, second, third, fourth and fifth. Okay, so now if you remember the flexor digitorum longus, it will be going to all these four, it will divide into four splits into four tendons and it go to the lateral four digits, and that will be getting inserted to the distal phalanx. If you remember the base of the distal phalanx. Now see, the compare this with the flexor digitorum brevis. This will also divide into four tendons, but it will not go into the distal phalanx, but it will go to the middle phalanx and it splits. It splits into two and get inserted to the lateral four toes into the middle phalanx. Okay, middle phalanx here, it split into two. And between the two splits will be the passage of the flexor digitorum longus tendon here. So flexor digitorum brevis breaks into two, splits into two and get inserted to either side of the shaft of the middle toe, middle phalanx. And this flexor digitorum longus will pass through this split and goes and get inserted to the base of the distal phalanx. So this is how the flexor digitorum brevis and the longus will differ in their insertion. The nerve supply to this muscle is medial plantar nerve. If you remember, I told there are only four muscles which are supplied by the median plantar nerve, only four muscles. So if you remember the four muscles, the remaining 14 will be supplied by the lateral plantar nerve. So just remember these four muscles which are supplied by the median plantar nerve. So this is the first muscle which is supplied by the median plantar nerve, the flexor deltoidum brevis. So this is the muscle here, flexor deltoidum brevis. Now going to the second muscle, the abductor hallucis. So this is the muscle here which is called the abductor hallucis. This also take origin from the medial tubercle of the calcaneum as well as the flexor retinaculum. So this also take origin from the medial tubercle as well as the retinaculum here on the medial side. This is called the flexor retinaculum. And this get inserted to the medial side of the base of the proximal phalanx of the great toe. If you can see here, it is going and getting inserted to the medial side of the proximal phalanx. If you remember, in case of the hand, the thumb has two phalanges and the other the other fingers will have three phalanges. Similarly, in case of foot, the great toe will have two phalanges only, two proximal and distal, and the other digits will have three phalanges, proximal, middle as well as distal phalanx. So in case of the great toe, this muscle abductor hallucis is going to the base of the proximal phalanx. So medial side of the base of the proximal phalanx of the great toe. So it is going on the medial side and getting inserted. So whenever it contract, it will abduct. So it will be abducting, it will bring it towards the medial side. So this abduction for the great toe. So it will help in abduction. So nerve supply again by the medial plantar nerve. I said four muscles are supplied by the medial plantar nerve. Out of these two are supplied within the first layer of the sole. The two muscles here are flexor deltoidum brevis and the abductor hallucis, both are supplied by the medial plantar nerve. As the name indicates, whichever muscles on the medial side, it usually supplies the muscles on the medial side. So these are the two muscles which are supplied by the medial plantar nerve in the first layer of sole. Okay. Action, it helps in the abduction of the great toe. As the name indicates, it is the abductor, so it will help in the abduction of the great toe. And flexor deltoidum brevis, so this will be, as the name indicates, flexor, so it will be helping in the flexion of the other four toes, lateral four toes. Okay. Now going to the third muscle, that is the abductor deltoidum minima. This is the muscle here. So this muscle has a big origin. The whole origin cannot be seen because this is covered by the flexor deltoidum brevis. If not, it will be taking origin from both the tubercles, medial as well as the lateral tubercle of the calcaneum. As well as it will be taking also some part will be taking origin from the lateral intermuscular septum. Okay, so this is an additional origin. If not, it will be usually mainly taking origin from the medial and lateral tubercles of the calcaneum, both this medial as well as lateral tubercles of the calcaneum, and it will also go toward the proximal phalanx of the little finger and get inserted to the lateral side. So this will be getting inserted to the lateral side of the little toe, the proximal phalanx of the little toe. The nerve supply is by the lateral plantar nerve, as of course, because it is on the lateral side, it cannot be supplied by the medial plantar nerve. So this is supplied by the main trunk of the lateral plantar nerve, and as the name indicates, it helps in the abduction of the little toe. Because it is on the lateral side, it will pull towards the lateral side. What is abduction and adduction in case of the toes? You should remember, adduction is all the four or five digits coming towards the medial side. If you remember the hand, in the hand the axis of this fingers will be in the middle finger. The middle finger will not move, it will be the axis, and all other fingers, if they join together, that will be called as the adduction, and when they move outwards, then it is called as abduction. Similarly, in case of the foot, it is not the middle finger, but it is the second toe which will be acting as the axis. This will be the axis, and if all the digits move toward this side and the lateral digits towards the medial side, then it is called as the adduction. And if they move on the lateral side, in case of lateral three digits and the great toe towards the medial side, then it is called as the abduction. So if they all move towards this axis, then it is called as the adduction, and they move away from this axis, then it is called as the abduction. So here the little finger will pull laterally, so that will be called as the abduction. In case of this abductor hallucis, the great toe will be pulled laterally or towards the medial side, not towards the axis but away from the axis, then it is called as the abduction. Both are abduction, but they are moving in the opposite direction. Here the abduction will be if it moves toward the medial side, and here the abduction will be when it moves laterally, because the axis is here, the second toe will be acting as the axis. So this is the difference. In case of the hand, it will be the third finger which acts as the axis, but in case of the foot, there is slight difference. The second toe will be acting as the axis, so the axis passes through this. Okay, so this is about the three muscles of the first layer: the flexor deltoid brevis, abductor hallucis, and the abductor digiti minimi. These are the three muscles here: flexor deltoid brevis, abductor hallucis, and the abductor digiti minimi. So these are the three muscles. Now coming to the second layer. Second layer has how many muscles? Five. So it should be difficult, right? No, actually it is very easy here. So this second layer, even though it has five muscles, actually these are, out of five, four are lumbricals. What are lumbricals? If you remember, similarly in case of hand, we have lumbricals. Lumbricals are those muscles which look like worms. Okay, so these are called as lumbricals. Here in this foot, you can see these are the lumbricals here. And one muscle, this is called as the flexor digitorum accessorius. If you can see here, this is the muscle which is called as the flexor digitorum accessorius. It is also called as the, it is also called as the quadratus plantae. Quadratus plantae. Why it is called as quadratus plantae? Because it is quadrilateral in shape. If you remember, in gluteal region also there is a muscle called as the quadratus, which is that quadratus femoris, because it is in relation to the femur. Okay, that is called as quadratus femoris because it is quadrilateral in shape. Here also this quadrilateral in shape, so it is called as quadratus, but because it is in the foot, in the plantar surface, so it is called as plantae, quadratus plantae. It is also called as the flexor deltorum accessorius. Why it is called so? Now we will see in the original insertion, then we will discuss this. Okay, so in the second layer there is flexor deltorum accessorius and four lumbricals. Along with that, there are extensor tendons, flexor deltorum longus as well as the flexor hallucis longus. These are the tendons which are coming from the leg into the foot. Okay, this is the flexor hallucis longus as well as the flexor deltorum longus we already seen in the previous picture. So here you can see here, this is the flexor deltorum longus which is in the second layer. Okay, so to discuss the origin insertion, flexor deltorum accessorius. This muscle has two heads. The two heads will be taking origin from the two tubercles of the calcaneum. The medial head from the medial tubercle of the calcaneum. The lateral head will be taking origin from the lateral tubercle of the calcaneum. So these are the two heads of the origin of this muscle. Insertion, if you see important, see the insertion. Insertion is into the tendon of the flexor deltorum longus. So this muscle, this is the flexor deltorum longus here, which you already seen here also deep inside. This is the flexor, this is the flexor deltorum brevis. This is the longus which I was talking about, which comes from the leg. So this is the flexor deltorum longus muscle with the four tendon going to the distal phalanx of the lateral four toes. Okay, so this muscle will be inserting to this tendon. Usually it should be into the bone, but there is slight change here. It will be inserting into the tendon of the flexor deltorum longus, the origin from the two tubercles of the calcaneum, and the insertion to the this long flexor, that is flexor deltorum longus, which is coming from the leg. So what the action of this muscle? This muscle, because if you see the tendon, it is going from the medial side to the lateral side, and whenever this muscle contract, it is supposed to flex the lateral four digits, as the name indicates, flexor deltorum longus. But because the axis is slightly oblique, it cannot be exactly flexion. So to make this axis straight, this muscle, whenever this muscle contract, it will pull the tendon in the proper direction, and this will be bring the tendons back into the axis. So whenever this muscle, the flexor deltorum accessorius, will contract, this will be contracting in turn, will be contracting the lateral four digits, and it will be flexing the lateral four digit. So that's why it is called as flexor deltorum accessorius. Now you understood why it is called as flexor deltorum accessorius, because it will be assisting. Accessorius means assisting the flexor deltorum. longus. Okay, so that's what is called as flexor deltoid muscle, or it is also called as the quadratus plantae because it is a quadrilateral muscle and it is in the plantar surface. Then we have the four lumbricals here. Okay, so the nerve supply of this is by the lateral plantar nerve, and then action, as I already said, it straightens the pull of the flexor deltoidum longus, the flexor tendons. So as I said, it will be straightening the action of this four tendons, straightens the pull of the long flexor tendon, that is the flexor deltoidum longus. That's the function of this flexor deltoidum accessorius. Now coming to the four lumbricals. The first lumbrical is unipinnate, and the all other three muscles will be bipinnate. If you what is unipinnate, if the fibers are in one direction, then it is called as unipinnate. This is the unipinnate muscle, the first lumbrical. As I said, all the numbers will be from medial to lateral side in case of the foot. Okay, so because this is the first digit and this is the second digit and the third, fourth and fifth, so these lumbricals are also numbered from medial to lateral side. This is the first one, this is the second, third and fourth. So these, the fibers of this muscle are all in one direction, so that's why it is called a unipinnate. Compare this with the second. So if you can see here, the fibers of this muscle are in two directions, one coming from the lateral side, another coming from the medial side, joined together. Similarly, see here in the third, some fibers coming from lateral side, some fibers coming from medial side. Compared with again with the fourth, also we have bipinnate. So these lateral three are bipinnate and the first one is unipinnate. So all this will be taking origin from the flexor deltoidum longus tendon. So this all these four muscles, four lumbricals are taking origin from the flexor deltoidum longus, to which the quadratus plantae is inserted. So that's why this tendon is very important in case of the second layer of the sole. And the insertion of this muscles will be into the extensor expansion. If you remember, in case of the hand also, we had something called as the dorsal deltoid expansion or extensor expansion. Similar in case of the foot also, if you see, this whole of the digits are covered by a thick modified deep fascia, and this is called as the extensor tendon because it is on the dorsal surface mainly. So if you can see here, this is the lumbrical. So it is actually in the plantar surface. Here if you can see, this is the flexor deltoidum longus tendon going on the plantar surface and getting inserted to the base of the distal phalanx. But see the lumbrical, even though it is taking origin from the tendon, it goes here and then it winds, it goes from the sole into the dorsal surface, superior surface in case of the foot. Okay, so this is the lumbrical which is on the plantar surface. From there it goes to the dorsal surface and get inserted to this dorsal digital expansion. So this is the insertion of this muscle. So even though this is in the, because this muscle is going to the dorsal surface, so even though it is in the plantar surface, but it doesn't flex, but it will be extending. Extension of the digits are the interphalangeal joint is the main action. Even though the lumbricals are in the plantar surface, but they are supposed to be flexing, but because these muscles cross and they go to the dorsal surface, so even though they are in the plantar surface, they will be extending. Okay, so they maintain the extension of the digits at the interphalangeal joint. So interphalangeal between the two phalanges, that is called interphalangeal joint, and this, because it crosses and goes to the dorsal surface, whenever it contracts, it will be extending these joints here, interphalangeal joint between the two phalanges. Nerve supply of these lumbricals is, the first lumbrical is supplied by the medial plantar nerve and the remaining three are supplied by lateral plantar nerve. So the first lumbrical is supplied by the medial plantar nerve and the remaining three are supplied by the lateral plantar nerve. So we have seen in the first layer there are two muscles supplied by the medial plantar nerve. In the second layer there is one lumbrical which is supplied by the medial plantar nerve. Now there is one more muscle which is supplied by the medial plantar nerve, the third layer, and if you remember these four, all other muscles are supplied by the lateral plantar nerve. Coming to the third layer, as you remember, again the formula is 3-5-3-7. So in the third layer there are three muscles. So the three muscles here are the flexor hallucis brevis, again hallux, so it will be in the medial side. So this is the flexor hallucis brevis, then the flexor digiti minimi. So here is the flexor digiti minimi, and here is the adductor hallucis. So these are the three muscles which are in the third layer. Begin with the flexor hallucis brevis, the first muscle, flexor hallucis brevis. If you see here, the origin is Y-shaped tendon. If you see here, it will be a Y-shaped tendon taking origin from two sides. The lateral limb will be taking origin from the medial part of the cuboid bone. If you see here, so it is taking origin from the lateral side from the cuboid bone, and the medial limb is a direct continuation of the tendon of the tibialis posterior. If you see here, the tibialis posterior tendon comes and get inserted to the cuneiform, medial cuneiform, as well as the navicular bone. So this continuation of this will be the flexor hallucis brevis. So this is a tendon of the tibialis posterior getting inserted to the navicular bone as well as the medial cuneiform, and this continues as the flexor hallucis brevis. So these are the two tendons or the two limbs of this muscle called as the flexor hallucis brevis, two heads, or we can call it as two heads. So this is the origin of this muscle, the lateral limb taking origin from the cuboid bone, here, and medial limb taking origin directly as a continuation of the tibialis posterior getting inserted to the navicular bone as well as the medial cuneiform. Insertion, it will divide, split into two, one on each side of the base of the proximal phalanx of the big toe or the great toe. So it will have two parts, and the two parts will go on either side to the base of the proximal phalanx and get inserted to the base of the proximal phalanx of the great toe. So it will be getting inserted on either side. So it has two origins, two heads or two limbs, and getting inserted again on the two sides of the proximal phalanx of the great toe. And if you observe here, there are small bones here within this tendon. These are called as sesamoid bones. If you remember, the largest sesamoid, it is in case of the knee joint, that is the patella. Patella is said to be the largest sesamoid bone. What is sesamoid bone? Sesamoid bones are those bones which are within the tendons of the muscles. Sesamoid bones are those bones which are within the tendon. If you can see here, these are small bones which are within the tendon of this muscle called as the flexor hallucis brevis. So these are called as sesamoid bone. But the largest sesamoid bone is, as I said, the patella, which is within the tendon of the quadriceps muscle. Quadriceps, the four muscles of the anterior compartment of the thigh. So this muscle is also supplied by the medial plantar nerve. So this is the fourth muscle. So the first two are supplied in the first layer, which are supplied by medial plantar nerve. In the second layer, there is one muscle, and in the third layer, there is one muscle. These are the four muscles which are supplied by the medial plantar nerve. All other muscles are supplied by the lateral plantar nerve. So the action, as the name indicates, flexor hallucis brevis. So it means it will be flexing the great toe, and it is a short muscle within the foot. So it flexes the proximal phalanx of the big toe or the great toe. Okay. So the second muscle is the adductor hallucis. If you can see here, this is the adductor hallucis. So this has two heads. One is the oblique head. This is the oblique head here. And the second is the transverse head. So this is the transverse head, and this is the oblique head. Oblique head will be taking origin from the bases of the second to fourth metatarsal. If you see here, these are the four metatarsals. The first metatarsal here, second, third, and fourth. This is the fifth. So this muscle will be taking origin from the bases of the second, third, and the fourth metatarsal, second to fourth metatarsals. And the transverse head will be taking origin from something called as a deep metatarsal ligament. If you see here, there is some ligament which is called as nothing but the modified deep fascia, which is called as a deep metatarsal ligament, which will be holding all the digits together. So this muscle will be taking origin from this deep metatarsal ligament. This is called the transverse head. So this muscle has two heads, the oblique head and the transverse head. And all this will get inserted to the lateral side of the base of the proximal phalanx. So it will be getting inserted to the lateral side of the base of the proximal phalanx. So what is the action? Whenever they contract, they will bring it toward the axis. This is the major second digit is the axis. So it will be pulling it towards the axis. So that's why it is called as the adductor hallucis. Okay, the nerve supply, now you know all other muscles are supplied by the lateral plantar nerve. So this is also supplied by the lateral plantar nerve, mainly the deep branch. And the action, as you know, the name indicates, it is the adductor of the great toe or big toe. Also, it helps in the maintenance of the transverse arch of the foot, because it is crossing from the lateral to medial side and it is transversely placed. So this also helps in the maintenance of the anterior transverse arch. There are two transverse arches, anterior and posterior. So this will help in the maintenance of the anterior transverse arch. Coming to the third muscle, that is the flexor digiti minimi brevis. So this is the flexor digiti minimi brevis. So this will be taking origin from the fifth metatarsal bone. If you can see here, this is the fifth metatarsal, this is the base of the fifth metatarsal. So this will be taking origin from the fifth metatarsal and getting inserted where? To the little toe, on the proximal phalanx, on the lateral side. So it will be getting inserted to the lateral side or the base of the proximal phalanx of the little toe. Nerve supply, again, as you know, this is supplied by lateral plantar nerve, and this will be the superficial branch. And the muscle action of this muscle is, as the name indicated, it will be flexing the little finger, so or the little toe. So it will help in the flexion proximal phalanx of the little toe. So these are the three muscles of the third layer. Now coming to the fourth layer, how many muscles are there? 7 3 5 3 7. So 3 5 3 7, so 7 muscles in the fourth layer. So it should be really difficult. No, it is very easy again. So as I said, the fourth layer has 3 plantar introcei and 4 dorsal introcei, totally 7. So these are the muscles in the fourth layer, 3 plantar introcei and 4 dorsal introcei. Compare again, in case of the hand, there are 4 plantar introcei as well as 4 dorsal introcei. Here there are 3 plantar introcei and 4 dorsal introcei. That's the difference. Okay, so here you can see the dorsal introcei, which can be seen from the dorsal surface, superior surface of the foot. So these are the dorsal introcei. And plantar introcei, you can see here the small muscles here which are clubbed along with the dorsal introcei. If you can see here, this is dorsal introcei, and slight difference in the color, it is slightly pinkish. So these are the plantar introcei. There are 3 plantar introcei, 1 2 and 3, and dorsal introcei there are 4. Okay, so what is the origin of these muscles and the insertion? The 4 dorsal introcei will be bipinnate muscle, as you can see in the picture. So the muscles are coming from 2 direction. So it is bipinnate and it will be taking origin from the either side of the metatarsal shafts. So the bipinnate muscle from the adjacent sides of the metatarsal bones. Okay, so they are taking origin from these are the metatarsals, starting from medial to lateral, 1 2 3 4 and 5. In between the first and second will be the first dorsal introcei, which take origin from here, and it will be going to the base of the proximal phalanges, and along with that also get inserted to the dorsal digital expansion. If you can see here, it is getting inserted to the dorsal digital expansion, and this is also supplied by the lateral plantar nerve. Coming to the plantar introcei, so this is same for all the 4 muscles. Similarly, the plantar introcei, there are 3, and if you can see here, these are all unipinnate. Only if you see, these are pinkish, these are the 3 muscles. So these are unipinnate muscles, and they'll be taking origin from the adductor side of the 3rd to 5th metatarsal. So this is the adductor side, this is the axis, if you can see here. So this is the axis of this foot. So here the axis has been shown. So they are taking origin from the adductor side. This is the adductor side and this is the abductor side. So they are taking origin from the adductor side of the lateral 3 toes, 3rd, 4th and 5th toe. Where they get inserted, similar to the dorsal introcei, similar to the dorsal introcei into the dorsal digital expansion as well as the dorsal surface of the proximal phalanges. Okay, nerve supply again by the lateral plantar nerve. What is the action of these muscles, the dorsal and plantar introcei? Together, the first action of these seven muscles is, it prevents buckling of the toes. What is buckling of the toes? If you remember the claw hand, in case of the hand, claw hand. Similarly, if it happens in case of the foot, it is claw foot, or it is also called as the buckling of the toes. So oppose excessive extension of the metacarpophalangeal joint and excessive flexion at the interphalangeal joint. That is called as the actually if it is present, then it is called as the buckling of toes, or it is similar to the claw hand. Okay, so this is called a buckling of toes, and this prevents this action. It opposes the excessive extension at the metacarpophalangeal joint. So it flexes the metacarpophalangeal joint and it prevents the excessive flexion at the interphalangeal. So it will be extending the phalangeal joints, if you remember, because these are all getting inserted to dorsal digital expansion. So if you guys can see here, so these are the dorsal introsciae getting into the dorsal digital expansion, lumbricals also getting inserted to the dorsal digital expansion. So all their action, lumbricals as well as dorsal and plantar introsciae, is this one. They prevents the buckling of the toes. Along with that, the dorsal introsciae, these muscles, the four muscles, help in the abduction of the toes. What is abduction? As I said, if you can see here in this arrow, they have shown this purple colored arrow. With the dorsal introsciae, it is help in abduction. So all the digits, if they move away from the second digit towards the lateral side and medial side, medial side for the great toe and lateral side for the other toes, then it is called as the abduction. So this is done by the dorsal introsciae. Compare with the dorsal introsciae of the hand, there also the dorsal introsciae will help in abduction, and the palmar introsciae help in the adduction. Here in the similar fashion, the plantar introsciae will help in the adduction. What do you mean the adduction? If all these other digits come towards the second digit, then it is called as the adduction. So the plantar introsciae help in the adduction of the toes. So the plantar introsciae help in the adduction of the toe, and dorsal introsciae help in the abduction of the toes. So these are the four layers of the sole, and the muscles within these four layers. The first layer having three muscles, second layer having five muscles, the third layer having three muscles, and the fourth layer having the four muscles. The four plus three, that is the seven, sorry, and the fourth layer will be having the seven muscles, four plus three muscles, four dorsal introsciae and three plantar introsciae. Now coming to the blood supply of the sole, it is mainly supplied by the lateral plantar artery. If you see this picture, so here is the tibial nerve and the posterior tibial artery. If you remember, these are the two structures which will be supplying the posterior compartment of the leg. All the muscles are supplied by the tibial nerve and the posterior tibial artery. So they supply these posterior compartment of leg. Now they are entering the foot. When they enter the foot, this posterior tibial artery divides into a lateral plantar artery and a medial plantar artery. So these are the two branches of the posterior tibial artery. So this lateral plantar artery is arching and it arches all the way and it supplies most of the muscles. So this is the main artery supplying the sole. So the lateral plantar artery is the main artery supplying the sole, along with contribution even from the medial plantar artery. Both are branches from the posterior tibial artery. Nerve supply, I have already told, out of the 18 muscles, only 4 are supplied by the medial plantar nerve. If you can see here, again, this is a tibial nerve, branches into medial and lateral plantar nerve. So medial plantar nerve, it is supplying only 4 muscles, and what you are seeing is here, the cutaneous supply. Even though it supplies only 4 muscles, but it will be having a larger cutaneous supply. If you can see here, this is the area, cutaneous means skin, the area supplied by the this medial plantar nerve on the skin, the sensory supply. So the motor supply is very small, only 4 muscles, but the sensory supply is big, if you can see here. Okay, and the remaining 14 are supplied by the lateral plantar nerve, and this is the lateral plantar nerve, which is again a branch from the tibial nerve. It supply most of the muscles, 14 muscles out of the 80 muscle, but see the area of the skin. It has a very small area of the skin. Lateral plantar nerve supplies only the dorsal surface, the plantar surface, 1.5 finger. Compare this with the ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve also, as I said, out of 20 muscles, 15 to 60 muscles are supplied by the ulnar nerve motor supply. But the sensory supply, again, the lateral, the medial 1.5 digits. So similarly here, the lateral plantar nerve will be supplying the plantar surface, only 1.5 finger digits, and this part of the sole. Along with this, there is also contribution from the tibial nerve directly, which supply the heel region. This is the sensor supply to the foot. So it is mainly by the medial plantar nerve, small area by the lateral plantar nerve, and the heel area supplied by the tibial nerve, along with contribution from the saphenous nerve. The saphenous nerve, as I said, is the longest nerve, which will be beginning in the femoral triangle and come all the way up to here and supply the sole. So small contribution here on the saphenous nerve, and this is the sural nerve, which is supplying the lateral side. So these are the four nerves or five nerves which will supplying the sole. This is the cutaneous supply, sensory supply. Coming to the dorsum of the foot, dorsum means the superior surface of the foot, also called as the dorsum of the foot. Okay, dorsum should be on the posterior side, but as you remember during development, as I said, because the lower limb has rotated medially, so the dorsum has come in the front, and this form the superior surface, or also called as the dorsal surface of the foot. It contains no aponeurosis like the plantar surface. There is a thick aponeurosis here. There is no need of the aponeurosis because this is less prone for damages from above. So there is no aponeurosis, and there are no muscles except one muscle called as the extensor digitorum brevis. So there is a small muscle here. This is called as extensor digitorum brevis. Remember, similarly, we have a muscle here. This in the anterior compartment of the leg. This is called as the extensor digitorum longus, which will be going to again to the lateral four digits. This is called extensor digitorum longus because it is a long muscle coming from the leg into the foot. This is the small muscle, extensor digitorum brevis, begins entrancing muscle, which begins in the foot and get inserted to the lateral four digits, similar to the longus. So it's called as the extensor digitorum brevis. This is the only muscle here in this region. So there is no aponeurosis, except there are two extensor retinaculums here. This is called as the superior extensor retinaculum, and this is called as the inferior Y-shaped inferior extensor retinaculum. These are two retinaculum, modified diaphysia, which you can see, but there is no aponeurosis. This area is supplied by one artery called as the dorsalis pedis artery. So if you can see here, this is the dorsalis pedis. This is nothing but a branch or the continuation of the anterior tibial artery. Anterior tibial artery is the artery which supplies the anticompartment of the leg, which is actually a branch from the popliteal artery. So this artery continues into the foot as the dorsalis pedis artery. This is a very important artery, again for the clinical skills, where you are supposed to examine the pulse of this artery called the dorsalis pedis artery, especially in case of the diabetic patients, as well as in case of a condition called as TAO in case of the smokers, where you are supposed to palpate this artery. Coming to the venous drainage on the dorsal surface, there is something called as the dorsal venous arch. Compare this again with the dorsal venous arch on in the hand. So there is something called a dorsal venous arch, which is a very important arch, especially when you want to give some IV injections or want to have something intravenous. So there is something called as an arch on the dorsal surface of the hand called as a dorsal venous arch. Similarly, in case of the foot, here there will be a dorsal venous arch, which has not been shown here. So there will be a dorsal venous arch, which is the arch which will be draining the foot and the lower part of the leg. Okay, so this dorsal venous arch will continue above from the medial side as the long saphenous vein, and this dorsal venous arch will continue laterally as the small saphenous vein. These are two important saphenous veins which will be draining the lower limb, the short and the long, and again these are clinically important because these are prone for varicosity, which is called as the varicose vein, which is very common in case of the lower limbs, especially those who stand for a long time. So this great and small saphenous veins start from the medial and the lateral side of the dorsal venous arch, which will be present here like this. Coming finally to the sensory nerve supply, as we have already discussed, in case of the leg, the superficial fibular nerve, which will be supplying only the two muscles of the lateral compartment of the leg, even though it will supply only two small muscles here, but it will come supply a large area on the dorsal surface of the foot. This is the sensory supply. Okay, motor supply only two muscles, but the sensory supply is very large. Compare this with the deep fibular nerve. So this is the deep fibular nerve here, if you can see here, even though it will supplying four muscles in the anterior compartment of leg, which is the nerve of the anterior compartment of leg, when it comes to the foot, it will be supplying a very small area of the skin. So usually you should remember that the nerve which supplies has a large sensory nerve supply will have a very small motor supply. Those nerves which will have larger motor nerve supply will have smaller sensory nerve supply. That will be vice versa for the other nerves which will be having a small motor supply will but have a larger sensory supply. Okay, so here the superficial fibular nerve supplies two muscles motor but a large area of the skin. The deep fibular nerve which supplies four muscles in anterior compartment but the skin area supplied is very small. Okay, along with that there is also contribution from the saphenous nerve which will supply in the medial side of the dorsum of the foot, and the lateral part will be supplied by the sural nerve. So this is the sensory supply of the foot and the nerve as nerve of this compartment, as well as the artery which are supplying this compartment. It is not big here, only the dorsal is pedis artery, because there is only one muscle, small muscle here, and the nerve, some sensory nerve supply is mainly by these four nerves: saphenous nerve, superficial fibular nerve, sural nerve, and the deep fibular nerve. So this is about the foot. Now we'll be discussing about the arches of the foot. Arches of foot are divided into two types: the longitudinal as well as the transverse type. And again, they are subdivided. The longitudinal is subdivided into medial longitudinal as well as lateral longitudinal arch. And the transverse arches are again subdivided into anterior transverse arch as well as the posterior transverse arch. So if you see here in this picture, so the bones forming the longitudinal, the medial longitudinal arch will be by these bones, which are shaded here. The calcaneus, talus, the navicular, the three cuneiform, medial, intermediate, as well lateral cuneiform, the first to third metacarpals, metatarsals, all this together will be forming the medial longitudinal arch. Those bones which are unshaded will be forming the lateral arch, which will be on the lateral side. So this is the lateral part of the calcaneus, the cuboid, as well as the fourth and the fifth metatarsals. So these are the arches and these are the bones which are contributing in the formation of these arches. The transverse arch will be the anterior transverse arch as well as the posterior transverse arch. That we'll see when we discuss with better pictures than this one. Okay. Before we discuss about the arches, we should know what are the functions of the human foot first. Why we should have the human foot and why this type? Okay. One thing is it supports the weight of the body. These human foots are specialized to support the weight of the body. The whole weight of the body will be going from the upper part of the body. All the weight will be bared by these lower limbs and especially the bones of the foot. Second is it serves as a lever to propel the body forwards during locomotion. When you see the shape of the foot, we'll discuss again in detail about the shape of the foot. This shape will actually help in propelling or throwing of the body in the front during walking. So this is called as the lever to propel. So it acts as a lever to propel the body forwards, to move forwards. How? This is by this small series of small bones here which are present within the foot. Why should we have these small bones? Why don't we have a single large bone? a single bone which can actually do this function. Okay, why should we have this small bone? That should be the question. So these small bones actually help the foot to adapt itself to move on uneven surface. Imagine a flat bone, big bone, and if you are walking on uneven surface, how do you adapt? It will not adapt. Okay, but if you imagine these small bones, there are so many multiple bones here, and they are arranged in such a fashion and such in an arch that when you keep it on any uneven surface, especially during olden times when we did not have slippers or shoe, and a person was supposed to walk on the rough surface and they have to climb mountains and other thing, they had to adapt their foot according to the shape of the bow, the surface over there. So this shape of the foot as well as the bones of the foot will very well adapt to different surfaces and even surfaces, and it helps in gripping the surface and putting the body weight on it. The second is the form of it. These small bones help in the formation of arch. If there is a single large bone, it cannot form an arch. So these small bones will, multiple small bones will form arches. If you can see here, this is the medial longitudinal arch, which is can be seen from the medial side, and this is the smaller lateral longitudinal arch, which can be seen from the lateral side. Now we should know what are the functions of this arch, why we should have the arches. Okay, one thing is, the first one will be, it acts as a springboard. You know, springboard is usually, you know, the swimmers, they know when they are supposed to dive, they go on a flat jumping surface, wooden flat extension, which will act as a propelling structure from where they will actually get the movement to jump and they dive into the swimming pool. So this is called as the springboard. So similarly, this foot, the shape of the foot acts, this arches of the foot acts as a springboard. They give the initial movement to the foot and to jump or move or propel your body forward. So it acts as a springboard. The second is, it acts as a shock absorber. If you see here, these bones, there are so many multiple bones, and whenever you jump from a height, if it is a flat single bone, when you jump on it, the whole body pressure will be transferred, the weight, everything will be transferred to the single bone, and it cracks open. But because of the small bones, when you jump from a height, they all actually they absorb the shock, and they slightly move and adjust themselves accordingly, and they disperse the whole of the body weight in different parts. So these the shape of these arches as well as the small bones will help actually as shock absorber. The third is proportional distribution of the body weight. Even if you are standing on uneven surface or somewhere, it has to be transmitted, the weight of this body will be transmitted equally on different parts, and there will be proportional distribution of the body weight, and so there is no pressure on single part of the foot. The fourth is, it acts as the segmented lever. We'll talk about this segmented lever later when we'll discuss each arch. Okay. The fifth is, protection of the plantar vessels and nerves. These arches actually, so they gave space here so that any structure can be safely safely hide here. So the nerves, especially the plantar vessels and nerves, will be passing through here. And if it is a flat bone, then again, if you are walking on uneven surface, on sharp objects or something like that, they will pierce and they will injure the structures. But because of this arch, they are much more safely preserved here inside this arch. And here we have the muscles as well as tendons as well as the plantar aponeurosis, which you have already seen. So all these will give additional support. So this idea, this arching of the foot will help actually protect the plantar vessels, nerves and other structures within the sole of the foot. And the fifth or the sixth is the shift of weight distribution. If there is any shift of the weight distribution, it will be equally distributed again, as I said, in the proportional distribution of body weight, and then it helps actually the foot to bear the weight. Okay, so these are some of the functions of the arch. it acts as a springboard. The second, it acts as a shock absorber. The third is proportional distribution of body weight. Fourth is segmented lever. Fifth is protection of plantar vessels and nerves. And sixth is shift of weight distribution. Okay. Now we'll discuss the factors responsible for maintenance of these arches. We'll discuss this in general right now, and later we'll discuss for each specific arch. Okay. One is the shape and arrangement of the bones. If you see here, the shape of these bones is very peculiar, as well as the arrangement. But these peculiar shape bones, as well as their arrangement, actually helps in the formation of the arch. Okay, so these bones, actually their different shapes and sizes, as well as arrangement, helps the arch to be present there. The second is intersegmental ties or ligaments and muscles. If you see here in the sole, there are so many muscles, as well as there are ligaments, as well as even the tendons. All these will actually help as intersegmental ties or ligaments within the foot, and which again helps the maintenance of the arches. We'll discuss more in detail about this when we come to each arch. Third is, it acts as a tie beam or bowstring. If you see here in the arches, later we'll see where there will be tie beams, or there are strings which will be preventing the arch from collapse. Okay. And fourth is, there are also slings which are coming, the muscles which are in the leg, they come here and they form a sling, and they will be pulling the arch upwards so that it can be maintained as an arch. So these are some of the factors which help in the maintenance of the arches in general. When we come to again in detail about each arch, then at that time we will discuss them again in much better way. Okay, in this picture, if you can see here, these are the structures which will be actually touching the floor. When you take an impression of the foot, only you can see the heel, the ball of the little toe, as well as the ball of the great toe. So these are the three structures which will be touching the floor. So it means that the other parts are actually they are above the surface, the level of the surface. Okay, and even sometimes you can see the balls of the other three toes here. Okay, but in a smaller fashion. But the main thing will be the heel, which is formed by the calcaneum, the ball of the great toe, as well as the ball of the little toe, which are the heads of the metatarsals. Coming to the first one, which is most important, is the medial longitudinal arch. Okay, if you understand this arch, then you can understand the lateral arch much easily. Okay, so the first one is the medial longitudinal arch. As the name indicates, it is medially placed. So it is on the medial side near the great toe, and it is longitudinal arch. It is from anterior to posteriorly. So this is called as medial longitudinal arch. It is represents the big arch of a small circle. Actually, this is the biggest arch in the foot. So it is very prominent. So it is big arch of a small circle. If you continue this arch, it will form a small circle. So this is the big arch of a small circle. What are the bones forming this arch? It is, as we have already discussed, the bones which are on the medial side, especially the medial part of the calcaneus, the talus, the navicular bone, the three cuneiforms, the medial, intermediate, as well as lateral cuneiform, as well as the first, second and third metatarsal bone. These will be the bones which will be forming the medial longitudinal arch. What is the summit or the highest point in this arch? That is formed by the talus, high and formed by the trochlear upper surface of the talus. If you see here, this is the talus. So this is the highest point of this arch that forms the summit. Then what is the pillar? What is the posterior pillar? Okay, so whenever there is an arch, so there should be two points which will be touching ground. So the posterior pillar is formed by the medial tubercle of the calcaneum. So this is the calcaneus bone here. So the medial tubercle of the calcaneus will form the, which will be actually touching the floor. So that will form the posterior pillar. What is the anterior pillar? It is formed by the heads of these three metatarsal bone. The first, second and third metatarsal bones heads will be forming the anterior pillar. What is the function of this arch? As we have already discussed the in general about all the arches, the functions, along with that, this the main function of this arch will be it acts as a shock absorber. That is the main function. Whenever you jump from height, so this is the main arch which is important, responsible for the absorption of all the shock and prevents from fractures and other things. What is the characteristics feature of this medial longitudinal arch? It is more resilient because of the more bones and joints. Because there are more bones here, as well as because there are more bones, so there should be more joints between these bones. So that's why this joint actually arch is much more resilient compared to the other arches, because there are lesser bones as well as lesser joints. So what are the factors which maintain the medial longitudinal arch? We had discussed these in general. Now we'll be specific. The shape of the bones, shape of the bone, especially the talus in this. Okay, so they are wedge shape. The talus at the center acts as the key bone or the keystone. So if you see the arch, whenever you see an arch, so there will be one stone which is most important, that will be called as the keystone. So this will be the keystone, and if you remove this keystone, the whole arch will come down collapsing. So that is such an important stone, which is the main stone, that will be called as the keystone. Okay, similarly we have the key stone here, which is actually the key bone, which will be the talus bone here in case of the medial longitudinal arch. We have seen the picture before. So this arch is especially stabilized by the talus. If you remove the talus, the whole arch will come collapsing down. So that's why this is called as the keystone or the key bone of this arch. The second is the intersegmental ties, which acts as the metal staple. If you see this arch, between the two bones, these two bones are fixed by something called as the metal staples. If you know the staples which pin which will be pinning the paper, they will all keep the all the bundle of papers together. Similarly, these staples will keep the stones together. Similarly, we have in case of the foot, we also have metal staple. These will be the ligaments, especially the plantar ligaments like the plantar calcaneonavicular, or it is also called as the spring ligament. If you can see here, this is a small ligament but very important ligament. This is called as the calcaneonavicular ligament, which is on the plantar surface, and this is called as the spring ligament, which is a very important ligament which acts as the metal staple in case of the medial longitudinal arch. The third factor is factors acting as the tie beams. So which are the factors which will be acting as the tie beam? Especially the medial side of the plantar aponeurosis, which will be acting as the tie beam. If you remember the plantar aponeurosis, it will be connecting the calcaneus behind, and anteriorly it will be going to the five digits and they will be connecting. So this acts as a tie beam. If you see here in this arch, so this arch, the two ends or the two pillars are tied together so that they don't grow apart from each other and hold. If these two ends will go apart, then this arch again comes down collapsing. So to prevent that, they will be always, the two ends will be always tied together. So this is called as the tie beam. So in case of the foot, the plantar aponeurosis, especially the medial side of it, for the medial arch, it will be the medial part of the plantar aponeurosis which acts as the tie beam. The muscles of the first layer of the sole also act as the tie beam. The tendon of the flexor hallucis longus, this also acts as the, if you can see here in this, this is the tendon of the flexor hallucis longus, which is actually coming from the posterior compartment of leg, and it will be pulling and get inserted to the distal phalanx, the base of the distal phalanx. So whenever it contracts, it will pull it backwards and it keeps the arch as it is. So this also acts as the tie beam, as well as the medial plantar part of the flexor deodorum longus, as well as the flexor hallucis brevis. All these will be helping and acts as the tie beam for this arch. That is the part which will be keeping the two ends of this arch together, and they prevent the collapse of the arch. Here you can see here in this picture, they have shown you the plantar aponeurosis, which is connecting the calcaneus behind to the anteriorly to the phalanges actually, and it will be it cannot be stretched, it cannot be pulled up because it is just an aponeurosis, but it will be holding the two ends of the two pillars of this arch together. So that's why this is very important one. Along with that, you can see the other muscles as well as tendons which are present here, flexor digitorum, brevis and other things which keep the arch together. Here also you can see the plantar aponeurosis, which is holding the calcaneus as well as to the metatarsals as well as the phalanges together, and this will keep the arch in its position. So if it breaks, then it might come down if there is other, if the even these other tie beams are removed. Okay, so all these are important structures which will be keeping the arch in its position. Here you can see here this is the spring ligament, the plantar calcaneovicular ligament, which is the spring ligament which we have already discussed before, okay, in the intersegmental tires, which acts as the metal staple. Now going to the fourth factor which is responsible for the maintenance of the arch is the suspending the arch from above, which acts as a sling. The tendon of the tibialis anterior and tibialis posterior will be actually acts as the slings and hold the arch in its position. The tendon of the flexor hallucis longus has been shown here, as well as the other tendons like the tendon of the tibialis posterior here, as well as the tendon of the tibialis anterior, which will be inserted to the medial side. Tibialis anterior coming from the anterior compartment of leg, and tibialis posterior coming from the posterior compartment of the leg. Both will be coming towards the medial side and pull it upwards, and they acts as a sling. If you can see here, so this is the tibialis anterior here, as well as the tibialis posterior. Both are coming down and they will pull the arch upwards on the medial side. So they act as a sling. So this is how a bridge is suspended. This is the arch here in this and this is suspended from above. This is called as a sling. Similarly, here the tibialis anterior and posterior will be actually acts as the sling, and they will hold the arch in its position. So all these are the four factors which are responsible for maintenance of the medial longitudinal arch. Now coming to the lateral longitudinal arch. So this lateral longitudinal arch, as the name indicates, it's on the lateral side as well as it is longitudinally placed. Okay, so this is the lateral longitudinal arch. This is a much smaller arch compared to the medial longitudinal arch. It is a small arch of a big circle. So if you continue it as a circle, then it becomes a very big circle. So this becomes a small arch of a big circle. Summit, what is the summit? The highest point, low, and lies at the subtalar joint. So below the talus there is a subtalar joint, so that will be the summit of this lateral longitudinal arch. What are the bones forming? That will be the calcaneus bone. You can see here, this is the calcaneus has shown here. Then we have the cuboid bone, here we have the cuboid bone, here we have the cuboid bone, and the two metatarsal, the fourth and the fifth metatarsal. These are the four bones which will be forming the lateral longitudinal arch. The number of bones are lesser here, as well as the joints, because of the lesser bones, lesser joints here, okay, compared to the medial longitudinal arch. What is the posterior pillar? Again, it is by the calcaneus, but it is by the lateral tuber. In case of the medial longitudinal, it will be the medial tubercle. Here, because it is the lateral longitudinal arch, this is formed by the lateral tubercle of the calcaneus. Anterior pillar by the fourth and fifth heads of the metatarsals. Heads of the fourth and fifth metatarsal will be forming the anterior pillars. What is the most vulnerable part? It will be the calcaneocuboid joint. So here is the calcaneocuboid joint, that is the most vulnerable part, that is more prone for damage. What is the characteristic? It is more rigid compared to the lateral medial longitudinal arch. As I said, medial longitudinal arch is much more resilient because of more bones and more joints. This has less more joints as well as less bone, so it is more rigid because of less joints as well as the bones. Function. What is the function? Main function apart from the general function, especially it will be helping in transmitting weight and thrust to the ground. Whenever you jump from a height, it helps in the equal distribution of the transmission of the weight, as well as whenever the thrust is on the ground, it prevents from collapse. So what are the factors which maintain this lateral longitudinal arch? Again, going to the first one, that is the shape of the bones. Again, the bones are wedge shape here. Especially the calcaneal angle of the cuboid bone is a very important shape of the bone which maintains the lateral longitudinal arch. What is the intersegmental tears here? That is the long and short plantar ligaments. Here, if you can see here again, in the medial longitudinal arch, it was the calcaneonavicular ligament. Here, in case of the lateral one, it will be the short as well as the long plantar ligaments, which acts as the intersegmental tears. But that is the metal stipules. Here also you can see the long plantar arch as well as the short plantar arch, which maintain this again the lateral longitudinal arch. Factors acting as tie beams, especially the plantar aponeurosis. Here the lateral part of the plantar aponeurosis along with the muscles of the first layer of the sole, flexor deltorum longus tendon, as well as the flexor deity minimi brevis, that will be the structures which acts as the tie beam, especially the plantar aponeurosis. As we have seen already, plantar aponeurosis, how it acts as a tie beam, especially the lateral part, the muscles of the first layer of the sole, especially the lateral muscles of the first layer of the sole, flexor deltorum longus, as well as the flexor deity minimi brevis. All this will be helping in in the maintenance of the lateral longitudinal arch by acting as tie beams. And the sling acting from above, the tendon of the peroneus, longus, brevis and tertius. There it was the tibialis anterior and posterior in case of the medial longitudinal arch. In case of the lateral arch, it will be the tendon of the peroneus, longus, brevis as well as the tertius, or fibularis, longus, brevis and tertius. So here you can see here, this is the fibularis, longus, brevis and tertius will be the anterior compartment. All this will be, if you can see here, they will be arching and they will be going towards the lateral side. So whenever they act as a sling. If you can see here, this is the sling. Okay, especially the fibularis, longus, going all the way from the lateral side to the medial side, going to the first medial cuneiform as well the first metatarsal. So it acts as a sling, especially the peroneus longus. That's what has been shown here. So these tendons will be acting, especially the peroneus longus, along with the brevis and tertius, or which is also called as the fibularis longus, brevis and tertius, act as the slings acting from above. Here also they have shown you the peroneus longus, which is from the lateral side arching all the way toward the medial side, and this is the peroneus brevis going to the fifth metatarsal. Both will be pulling the lateral side of this arch upwards. So these factors will also help in the maintenance of the lateral longitudinal arch. Now coming to the two transverse arches, anterior transverse arch and the posterior transverse arch. If you can see here, this is how it is formed. So these are the arches from medial to lateral side, which is in the front and the back. These will be forming the anterior and posterior transverse arch. How it is formed, let's discuss. The first is the anterior transverse arch. Anterior transverse arch is a complete arch. So it will be a complete arch, which is formed by the heads of the five metatarsals. So it will form a complete arch. But the posterior arch is not complete, it is incomplete, and it is completed by the other foot. So only half of the dome will be completed by this arch, and the other half of the arch will be completed by the other foot. So the two foots are joined together at that time only when you join the two feet together, only at that time you can form the complete arch. If not, when there is only one foot, it will be only one half. So that's the difference between the anterior arch and posterior. Anterior arch will be completely formed, okay, because the two ends will be touching the ground. But in case of the posterior transverse arch, it is incomplete. Only half of the lateral side will be touching the ground, the medial side will be above. So when you join the other foot together, at that time it will form the complete arch. The second is difference between these two arches is the bones forming these arches. For the anterior transverse arch, it will be the near the heads of the five metatarsals. We have seen when you join the heads of metatarsals and keep it on the floor, only the first and the fifth will be touching the ground. When you take the impression, you already seen the impressions. When you take, it is only the first head as well as the head of the fifth metatarsal as well as the heel which will be touching the floor. So it means the first head as well as the fifth head will be touching. All the second, third and fourth will be above the ground. So they will be forming the arch, and the first and the second, fifth will be forming the pillars. But in case of the posterior transverse arch, it is formed, the bones forming will be the greater part of the tarsus as well as the metatarsals. So it will be mainly by the tarsal bones. So those tarsal bones will not be, only the lateral side of the tarsal bones will be touching, but the medial side it will be much more above, so they don't touch on the medial side. So only when you join the other foot, so again it will be completed by the other side. So this is the second difference between the anterior and posterior transverse arch. The third is the first and fifth metatarsal bones come in contact with the ground. As I said, the first and the fifth, these are the heads of, you imagine, these are the heads of the five metatarsal. Only the first and the fifth will touch the ground almost. The second, third and fourth will be high above. Okay, but in case of the posterior transverse arch, only the base of the fifth metatarsal will touch the ground. Only the fifth metatarsal will touch the ground. All other metatarsals as well as the, especially the tarsal bones, will not be touching the ground. Okay, so this will form only half of the dome. So these are the some of the differences between the anterior transverse arch and the posterior transverse arch. Anterior transverse arch is anterior place and it is complete arch. Posterior transverse arch is posterior place and it is incomplete arch, which is completed by the other foot. The anterior arch has is formed by the bones, that is the heads of the five metatarsal bones. The posterior transverse arch is formed by the, especially by the tarsal bones, as well as some contribution from the posterior part of the metatarsal bones. The third difference is the first and fifth metatarsal bones come in contact with the ground, so they will form the two pillars and it forms a complete arch. But in case of the posterior transverse arch, only the fifth base of the fifth metatarsal will touch the ground. All other metatarsal as well as the tarsal bones will not touch the ground, so it will have only one pillar, so it forms incomplete arch. So these are some of the differences between the anterior transverse arch as well as the posterior transverse arch. Now discussing what are the factors maintaining these transverse arches of the foot. Again, coming back to the shape of the bones, they are typically wedge shape. These are the same bones forming, so it has to be, they are typically wedge shape, especially of the three cuneiforms and base of the middle three metatarsals. These shape of the bones of this cuneiform as well as the bases of the metatarsal, now it is not the heads but the bases of the metatarsal, especially for the posterior transverse arch, will be helping in this maintaining of this transverse arch. The second is the intersegmental tears, especially these intersegmental tears are formed by the deep transverse ligament, other plantar ligaments, adductor hallucis muscles. All these factors will be acting as the intersegmental tears. The tie beams or the tendon of the peroneus longus brevis as well as the tibialis posterior will be maintaining the transverse arch. The slings acting from above will be from the peroneus tertius brevis, peroneus tertius as well as brevis on the lateral side, and tibialis anterior on the medial side. These are some of the factors which will be maintaining the transverse arch. Here you can see here the peroneus longus on the lateral side, and here you can see the tibial ischiae and posterior. So these on either side will be holding the transverse arch in its position, especially the peroneal structures and the brevis on the lateral side, which is present on the lateral side, as well as the tibialis anterior, which is present on the medial side. If you can see here, the tibialis anterior go deep down and goes all the way towards the lateral side. So these all these factors will be helping in the maintenance of the transverse arch. So this acts as a sling. So the tibialis anterior, it will be pulling the medial side of it so that it doesn't touch the ground. So these are some of the factors which will be maintaining the transverse arch of the foot. Now coming to the last part, that is the applied aspects related to the arches of the foot as well as the foot itself. The first one is the pes cavus. What is this? Exaggeration of the longitudinal arch. If you have the normal arch, it is good, fine and good, normal. But if it is exaggerated, then it is called as the pes cavus. And it is just opposite to that is the pes planus, where it is flat foot. If you can see here, if you take an impression of the foot, this is the normal one, where you can see the normal foot with especially the impression from the ball of the head of the first and the fifth metatarsal as well as the heel, and some impression, light impression about the other part of the foot. In case of the flat foot, this whole foot will be giving the impression. So because the whole foot, the arch has come down and it is almost touching the whole of the floor, so that's why that is called as the flat foot. Here, if you can see here, this is the picture showing the heel, the ball of the little toe and the great toe, which is supposed to give the impression. But in case of the flat foot, the whole of the foot will come down and it touch the ground, because there is no arch now or very small arch, and this will be the print when you take the footprint of this pes planus. Pes cavus is just the opposite. It is the high arch foot, very high arch foot. The third condition is the claw foot. Just like the claw hand, the claw foot can be there because of the damage to the anterior compartment, the nerve supplying the anterior compartment of the leg, which is the nerve supplying the anterior compartment of leg. It is the anterior tibial nerve, or the deep, it is also called as the deep peroneal nerve. So that is the which will be supplying the anterior compartment of leg, and if there is damage to that, it will be paralyze all the muscles of the anterior compartment of leg are paralyzed, and they don't have any action on the foot, on the digits of the foot, and the muscles of the posterior compartment of leg will be acting mainly, and that will pull all the digits of the toes, and that will make it a claw foot. So, and also the muscles of the intrinsic muscles of the foot also actually lead to the claw foot. The fourth is the club foot. Club foot is such a one which is again due into multiple types, but it is called as the talipes equinus, talipes calcaneus, talipes varus, talipes valgus, and the most commonest is the talipes equinus varus, which is the commonest one, where the foot is totally medially rotated medially. So there is actually the inversion of the foot, and you can see the total inversion of the foot, especially in case of the newborns, that is called as the talipes equinus varus. Sometimes the foot is averted outside, then it is called as the talipes valgus. So if it is just rotated medially, then it is called as the talipes varus. So these are some of the different conditions which together it is called as the club foot. Especially this is seen in case of this, usually it is genital, congenital, and you can see it is congenital abnormality which you can see, and the commonest will be the talipes equinus varus. And the fifth applied aspect is something called as the march fracture, especially when you march, especially the soldiers when they march Okay, they would be putting a lot of pressure on the foot, and this can lead to fracture of some of the bones in the foot. And whenever there is fracture of these bones, this is called as the march foot. Then there is a condition called as the hallucis valgus. If you have seen, the valgus is the eversion. Okay, and the hallux means the great toe. Great toe is sometimes averted outside. Okay, that condition is called as the hallux valgus. Okay, so these are some of the conditions which are related to foot. And the seventh one is called something called as the hammer toe. In case of the claw foot, all the digits are actually flexed, and whenever this is called as the claw foot. Sometimes there is actually hyperextension at the metacarpophalangeal joint, metatarsophalangeal joint, and the flexion at the interphalangeal joint. But sometimes the distal interphalangeal joints will be extended. So at that time, the toes will be averted and they will be directed forwards. So it looks like a hammer. So this is called as the hammer toe. So these are some of the conditions which we are supposed to know. And we have discussed the arches of the foot. The arches of the foot are divided into two types: medial longitudinal arch as well as the lateral longitudinal arch. These are the longitudinal arches. And the second type is the transverse arch, which is divided into anterior transverse arch as well as the posterior transverse arch. And we have discussed what is the importance of the arches and what are the factors in general. And again, when we discuss each arch, we discuss what are the exact factors, the four factors which are responsible for the maintenance of the arch. And finally, we have discussed the applied aspects related to this topic. So this was all about the arches of the foot as well as the foot itself. So if you have any doubts, you can write back to me and I will try to answer. Thank you. Thank you very much.